Okay, so we are at High Sierra Music Festival, and this is the On the Rocks podcast with Jeremy Korpas, and I'm sitting across from Natalie Cressman. She is trombonist extraordinaire, vocalist. She plays with Trey Anastasio Band, plays with Van Ghost out of Chicago, and her own project, Natalie Cressman, who's about to release a record. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks for doing this. So is this your first High Sierra?
Yeah. I've been hearing about it for years. I grew up in San Francisco, so it's one of the festivals out here that I've always wanted to check out. But yeah, this is the first year I made it up.
Great. What brings you out this time?
I'm here with Peter Apfelbaum and Sparkler, which is
excellent.
A new band I'm super excited about. We're mostly Californians, but we now live in New York. And it's a really eclectic mix of genres and kind of Afrobeat world, avant-garde vibe.
And that kind of fits from your background too. When you started playing, you were dealing a lot of like Afro jazz, Cuban jazz, stuff like that.
Yeah, I grew up in San Francisco, and both of my parents play a lot of Afro-Cuban and Brazilian music. Mm. So I definitely feel at home in like a more like Afro-Caribbean based style.
Right.
And Peter was one of my earliest mentors too. He kind of showed me the ropes about music when I was really, like, you know, 12 years
right.
old even. So I've kind of grown up kind of digesting his music, so it's really fun to be part of a project with him now.
Right. So you're about to put out your own record, and you did, would you do Kickstarter?
Yeah, the campaign was over like 2 days ago, so yeah.
And you met your
made
goal?
Made my goal, yeah.
Great.
Have a lot of cookies to bake for people. That was one of the prizes.
What was that whole experience like, just asking people for money, you know, to support music?
It's hard, and this is my second Kickstarter. I put out a CD a year ago and also crowdfunded it. And at first, I was a little hesitant, but at the same time, there's no infrastructure for a lot of musicians to get their music out right now. The record label thing is not really the way it used to be.
Right.
And I think it's a great way not only to get support, but to get, I've made a lot of great connections and gotten people behind my music through the Kickstarter, and I've made it a point to, put some great rewards in it for donors and follow through on them. I've actually, donated to some other people's Kickstarters who take a couple years to get you the CD, and that's kind of a drag. So I try to like turn things around and really give people what they deserve, because I really appreciate their help.
Right. What does this pay for? Does it pay for the album? Are you getting publicists?
Yeah.
Stuff like that?
Basically,
that seems to be the route now, is what these people are taking that money, making the record on their own and getting publicists to, because, what's good of a record if nobody hears it, right?
Right. I mean, and that's the thing is, like, if you go to a label, certain labels will pay for publicity and radio promotion, but then they'll have the rights to your CD, and you have to buy your own CDs back from them to sell. And that just kind of seems a little backwards to me. And most people don't even fund the making of the album.
Right.
So I funded the recording and the mixing of it and the mastering of it myself. And then this money is for CD packaging, manufacturing, and publicity, and like a radio promoter as well.
Did you write all the music for the record?
Six of the eight songs are my originals, and then I did two arrangements of some like covers. I did a Bon Iver tune, like in a very different way, Blindsided.
Sick, yeah.
Yeah, so I really like, I'm kind of in this new mode of singer-songwriter meets jazz, some weird jumble of all the kind of music I play in various settings, and it kind of just comes out as its own thing. So it's a lot less jazzy than the album that I put out a year ago. So it's kind of the direction I'm going.
Is that because your influences are changing, or yeah?
Yeah, I mean, I've always loved jazz, and I think it's, it's a beautiful style of music, but my problem with it is that a lot of people are trying to emulate things from the past that have already happened. And what I really like is kind of bringing more modern sounds into that and kind of seeing how they coexist. And I've never been one to like dissect and be like, this is this genre and it can't be, this can't belong here. I'm really motivated and inspired by groups that bring worlds together rather than fragmenting them.
Sure.
And so that's kind of what gets me really lit up about music. So that's kind of what I'm trying to do with my music, is let kind of let all my influences come out and not try to like push it too far in any direction for any commercial or right. aesthetic reasons. It's just kind of my own take on things, right. you know?
I think the cool thing about music now these days is it seems like, you know, every genre of music has just gotten stretched to every direction, you know, but it seems like it's starting to come back to songwriting.
Yeah.
Which is kind of what I'm really excited about, you mm-hmm. know, because like styles to me create limits, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I listen to bluegrass music. I listen to rock and roll. It's like, well, no, you know, there's great music to be had in all these genres, you know? So to me, it's like, I'm always about the song, you know?
Absolutely.
And I like hearing the fact that you're trying to bring that jazz world in there, because I feel like that might be the last one that's still kind of like had a hard time breaking through the mainstream, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's because I think a lot of people who grow up studying jazz, their heroes are people that were groundbreaking in the past.
Right.
And you can't really just keep regurgitating something that was groundbreaking 60 years ago.
Right.
I mean, it's great to know what that sound is and to be able to emulate it, but I don't think that's the end all be all of music, is to like replicate something that already happened.
Sure.
So
I mean, in any art, I
guess. In any art. Yeah. You want to have your own spin on it. And I think that for me, I've been super obsessed with songwriting because it is more direct and more human, and it's not, some jazz can be really esoteric and kind of, create this barrier between the audience. Like, we're too sophisticated for right. mere mortals to, you know, that's really not, I don't think that's where music is at. Like, I want to, you know, make people feel good or feel something. And so I think words really help like convey that
right.
even more than just instrumental music. So that's kind of why I'm singing a lot more on the album, and it's a lot more about the lyrical content.
Where do the lyrics come from? Is this things that like you start as poetry, or are they ideas, or do they just flow out of you?
It's funny because like I feel like every song kind of evolves in a different way. Like sometimes I have a melody that I think is going to be played on trombone, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, but this sounds like it could, you know, these words would fit here, and then all of a sudden it's a vocal tune. Other times it's like I wrote the song with like the title already in mind, and that kind of informs the music and the words. And then other times I have like phrases that I like save up. Like I sing a lot of times like a couple of lines into my iPhone when I'm just like going about my business day to day, and then every, you know, couple months I'll sit down and listen to them, and if one of them is like, oh yeah, I could turn that into a song, that's kind of what makes it take off. So I save little scraps of like words and phrases that I like and try to go somewhere with it.
Right. Do you have like a partner that you show your stuff to get?
Yeah. Well, I'm really lucky that my boyfriend and his best friend have a recording studio and a production company in Brooklyn. So anytime that I have something, even like in baby form, you know, I can bring it over, and it's a whole household of musicians, so I don't even really need to like call anyone over. It's right. like there's a drummer and a bass player and a guitarist, and let's go.
And
we can try things out there and even record it for fun. So that's kind of happened a bunch, and so I have him and my bass player to kind of bounce ideas off of. And even though it's like me leading the project and me writing the music, it's kind of gotten to this point where people are throwing their two cents in, which I really like. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a dictator in my band.
So playing in all of these projects, and they're definitely drastically different. I mean, just from Trey Band to what Van Ghost is doing,
mm-hmm.
I'm sure to what Peter is doing and stuff like that, and your own music. Do you find it hard to get your own voice out in those projects, or are those artists open to hearing what you have to say?
It's a mix of it, because I kind of like being able to take on different voices,
right.
you know, depending on what the music calls for. So I think inevitably it's always going to sound like me, but I definitely approach my job in Trey's band different than I do in my own. It's much more about blending into his vision, and there's room for me to solo and stretch and say my thing, but I'm definitely kind of tailoring it to what I think the music needs. So I think I do get room in all of those bands to you know, have my own voice be there, but I am definitely like playing to the style, and I think that's important, because I definitely wouldn't like play in a salsa band like I would play like bebop, and
right.
vice versa.
Right.
So there's just kind of having an ear for what is called for is something that I've worked on a lot.
It's probably the reason you're getting these jobs.
Right, and they're all over the place, which is cool, because it always is stretching me to like not get too comfortable in any one thing, which is good.
That's really cool. Are there any artists at High Sierra this year that you just have to see or are super looking forward to seeing?
Well, I was super blown away by Alan Stone yesterday. Like blew my mind. Uh-huh. That was incredible.
It's so weird how, I'm not sure exactly where he's from, but I think I heard he's from some really small town in the middle of nowhere, and like to have that kind of voice in that.
Oh my God. Right. I was so blown away. It was great. Definitely a highlight for me. And I saw Robert Plant last night, which was awesome.
Right.
And that Gimbri player was, oh my God.
I mean, it sounded like a horn at points.
It was
right?
Crazy. Yeah. Me and Jen Jen Hartswig, yeah. We were standing kind of further back and we were like, is that a horn? Oh, it's him. And it's right. Like, it's crazy. I love that the textures that he used. Everything was just like sonically so dialed in and great. So that was awesome. And I wish I could stay longer. We actually have to drive back today because Sparkler is playing in San Francisco tomorrow.
Who are you playing?
We're playing at the Fillmore Jazz Fest.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and then I'm playing on Sunday with my jazz group, Secret Garden, at the same fest. So we have to get back, but I want to stay.
I mean, it's a party to be had at this place.
I know.
Sure, right? You got some more time to talk? Or
yeah. I'm not really going anywhere. Okay.
So, all right. So, from my eyes, I would say you're successful, you know. Touring with Trey obviously has to bring some financial help and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So where you are now, what's the next level of success for you? What would be the next step for you? Mm.
Well, I just graduated from college, so as much as...
And what college was that?
Manhattan School of Music, right. In New York. And it was a great experience for me to be in New York, but at the same time, or be at school, but at the same time, it kind of limited me from taking on a lot of gigs and playing a lot with my band outside of New York. So I guess for me, I mean, success is interesting because I think I'm going to be kind of going for it, and that doesn't necessarily mean being financially successful, but just kind of, you know, investing in my project and trying to build something. And so you have to start small with that. But I'm excited for that. And I think the next step for me to feel successful is to be able to go on the road with my band. And we're doing that in August and on the West Coast.
Right.
But I'd like to do that on the East Coast and kind of really start, you know, playing different cities and maybe getting some new audience members in on it.
And what kind of role do you think social media plays, just with your own personal career? Like, how do you approach social media?
Yeah, it's interesting. I definitely have bought into social media, but I also have my qualms with it. Right. But it's a great promotional tool, but I've also found that like I have way more fun posting random tidbits about my life, and I started doing this baking blog where I like have musical guests that come and bake something with me, and then we record a song and we have that up on YouTube, and people respond more to that than like me being like, come to my gig. Uh-huh. So I think it's like you have to have like a well-rounded approach. You want to like connect with people and not just get them to like come to your show or buy your record, but like really like, you know, be accessible and reach out to them. And, you know, when someone says something nice about your video or whatever you tweeted, to like, you know, respond. I just think that's kind of the nice thing to do. And at this point, I'm not super famous, so I can do that, and I make the effort to like, you know, I won't let someone say something really sweet and heartfelt and not respond, because, right. You know, I just, you know, I don't want to.
It's a fine line, you know, talking to artists over the past couple of days about this exact thing is like, you know, some are very much into like posting the picture, I'm tying my shoe on the corner of the street, you know, and then some are very against that, you know,
yeah.
So it's interesting to see how people approach the whole thing. You know?
Yeah.
I personally like the way it gives you a little insider peek into somebody's world that you really care about. You know, mm-hmm. when somebody likes you on Facebook or Instagram or goes on your YouTube page, they're there because they want to be there. You know, they're reading your newsletters, they're reading your tweets because they want to, you know, mm-hmm. And so maybe a couple people might not want to see you tying your shoe on the road, but who cares? You know, what's the worst that happens? They unfriend you or they...
They can choose not to follow. But yeah, I think it's cool. It's also like, you know, I follow some of my, you know, role models and musicians that I like. And I get super, you know, I get into the little mundane things that they might post.
Right.
You know, I think it kind of just makes everyone feel kind of on the same level, like we're all humans with like kind of a regular life, and then, you know, you might perform in front of 10,000 people, but you also might be at home like making dinner and post that on Instagram. Like,
what's that like for you? I mean, going from playing in front of Trey audiences to some of the smaller audiences, I'm sure that you're running into.
Yeah, it's especially was weird, like, you know, playing the Beacon and then the next morning having to wake up at 8 to go uptown and go to class. And I also had like one teacher this year that I was on jam cruise for the first time, and she had like a super strict attendance policy, so I had to like buy internet to Skype into class so that I wouldn't get marked down a grade.
Right.
So it's like, it's kind of humbling. It's like, you know, it doesn't matter if you're, you know, already doing something, you kind of have to pay your dues, and like if you want this degree, you have to like, you know, wake up super early after like playing a 5-hour show and right. go to class.
I mean, I find that amazing. You know, I was I'm gonna have another artist on the show, Sarah Jaros. You know who she is?
I don't know.
Yeah, she's from Austin, Texas, and she's like a new grass player.
Cool.
But signed to Sugar Hill when she was 16, won a Grammy when she was 19.
Wow.
It's recorded, like, if you look at her, who's on her records, Jerry Douglas, Baylor Fleck, and just the big boys, you mm-hmm. know, and all at the same time going to Conservatory of Music in Boston, and like, she's, you know, she's your age, and I'm mm-hmm. like, how can you juggle all of that and college? It's just mind-blowing to
yeah,
me.
Yeah, it's definitely crazy, but if you want it, like, that's the thing, is it's right. so gratifying getting to make music with Trey and, you know, anyone else that has pulled me away from school for a couple weeks at a time, so you can't really complain, you know?
Right,
it's
sure.
like, you know, if you want both worlds, you have to do the work. It's not going to just magically happen.
I think you're nailing it right there. I mean, you have to do the work. I mean, that, you know, in all of our experiences, you I'm sure you've seen that. The hard workers are the ones that always
yeah.
come out on top.
Exactly.
You know, for sure. I mean, talent will only go so far because there's so much of it out there. I mean, mm-hmm. being in New York City, it's insane.
Yeah.
You know, I played in a band in New York for years, and we were kind of the house band at the bitter end.
Oh, cool.
And, like, you know, we play twice a month, and there was this band called Days of Wild that would go on after us, and they were this open kind of funk jam session,
mm-hmm.
and just this rotating cast of New York City musicians every week would come through and just roll in, take a solo, and leave. And mm-hmm. I'd walk out at 4 o'clock in the morning and be like, oh my god, like, there was 10 guitar players just rolled through that are a million times better than I can ever imagine being, you know. It's like, it's a tough scene to like,
yeah, oh
you know,
man, it's
it.
Super hard, and especially like being, you know, I have a lot of work in like the funk and jam scene, but I also do a lot of work in like, you know, the straight ahead jazz scene, and you know, so it's definitely challenging to want to feel like you're at the top in all those, you know, it's overwhelming, but I kind of get solace in thinking that I'm working as hard as I can, and that because of the weirdly different worlds that I play music in, that I kind of have my own thing to say, and that'll set me apart somehow down the road.
Right. Cool. Well, I mean, I'm not going to take up too much more of your time, so I just want to say thank you so much.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
The next time you see Berg,
yeah,
just give him the biggest hug and kiss for me.
I will. Definitely. I will. I'll give him a huge bear hug for you.
Cool. Enjoy the rest of your High Sierra. Have fun
thank
at your
you.
Gig in San Francisco, and hope to see you again.
Yeah, sounds good. Thanks
thank
so
you.
Much.
This is great.